On the hit TV series The Wonder Years, Karen Arnold was the free-spirited flower child who'd often clashed with her conservative father.
Hi, Paul.
Dad always said hi to our friends, but it was like he had this understanding with the family. He worked hard for us, he provided for us, and he certainly didn't want to have to talk to us on top of that. My approach was to not make any sudden moves or sounds until he'd finished that first vodka tonic and hope that nobody else did anything that might upset him too much before then.
I'm gonna get some birth control pills. I thought you should know.
It's hard to believe that was more than three decades ago. And Olivia D’Abo, who played Karen on The Wonder Years, joins us now from LA. Hello, it's lovely to talk to you this morning.
It's lovely to talk to you. Thanks for having me.
Karen really knew how to rile her father. Was she a fun character? And did you share any traits with her?
Many traits, I think. First of all, that's my favourite Karen line that I ever saw throughout the whole duration of the show, which was from the pilot. I think it really sets up and establishes the dynamic between myself and Jack Arnold. You know, I am sort of his, still will always be, since the show went on, you know, his little girl. Obviously, I'd grown into a young woman and moved in and with David Schwimmer toward the latter part of the show. We just had so much fun. And I think a lot of the similarities was that before I moved to Los Angeles, when my parents and I moved from London, England, we moved to a place called Taos, New Mexico. And I think I really, there was a lot of the riffraff of the sort of Easy Rider days, though it was in the late 70s. A lot of people still hadn't dealt with the fact that the 60s were actually over. And it's one sort of little melting pots in the United States that is very Americana and stays quintessentially Americana. And so I got this real sensibility of living a bohemian life as a child. And so it gave me a really great history lesson, I think, sort of as fate would have it, to embark upon the Wonder Years when it finally came my way.
So you felt right at home on that set, even though it was creating the world of the 60s, you actually felt very comfortable wearing all of those clothes and being that free-spirited character that you were.
I think so. I think also I was at the right age. You know, I was about 18 and I was very much a free spirit and rather rebellious anyway, as girls tend to be at that age. And so I really drew from that. I sort of, you know, picked up on the local osmosis of what was going on around me with all the incredible cast members. Fred was amazing. You know, he was this, you know, ostensibly 11-year-old who saw everything through an 11-year-old's mind, yet he was sort of like a 40-year-old man at the same time. And while all the narration was going on, we just had the opportunity to really react and take in his acting as well as what the narration was trying to sort of make a point about, which was very much speaking about the time and you know, the division in the country at that time with the Vietnam War, who were pro-Vietnam and not advocates of Vietnam. I personally was not pro-Vietnam. You know, I was a 60s flower power child. But Jack, my dad, having gone through the Korean War, was pro-war, you know, just because that was his era. He was from the baby boom years, so... you know, it just said a lot about the different generations in that time and the incredible history that America, I think, has lived yet to this day. You know, it's pretty remarkable. And of course, the show is, you look back on it now and it's a little bit like, it's like a history lesson for kids who are a lot younger and they didn't see the show when it first came out. But it's also a great
American classic nostalgic piece.
So yes, true. Yeah. You spoke of Fred there, of course, Fred Savage, who's now a revered director, directing some really important stuff. But the show had some then unknown guest stars who had become big names. John Corbett guested as your boyfriend, and you mentioned David Schwimmer, who also played your partner. Let's take a look.
What do you mean you live here? What does he mean he lives here?
You didn't tell him yet.
Well, I didn't quite get around to it yet.
Tell us what?
Mom, Dad, I told you that I was going to be sharing a house with somebody.
Nice to meet you.
Somehow, I guess I'd envision Karen's roommate a little less male.
What was David Schwimmer like to work with?
Amazing. My favorite episode is where David is at the house that Karen and David live at, near Haight-Ashbury, and Jack and Wayne and Kevin show up, and they're coming to get my things out because Karen and Michael have had a fight. And Jack gets to the lingerie cupboard. And there's this amazing shot where I think the camera's underneath the lingerie and it's obviously a transparent drawer. But you can see Karen's lingerie and you look at Jack's face, is just like, he's just about to volcanically erupt. And of course, what father wouldn't if they're seeing... that their daughter's lingerie collection and moving them out of the house. He was an incredible actor to work with and an incredible person to work with. He just always was so kind. And, he reminded me initially of sort of a puppy dog mixed with a Nicolas Cage kind of...
Is that how you would describe Arnold Schwarzenegger? Your first film role was alongside Arnie in Conan the Destroyer. What was that like?
Well, he was certainly far from a puppy dog, but he was an incredible presentation of strength and encouraging and very inspirational to all of us. He got us all up at sort of 4:30 a.m. He'd knock on the door. It's time for everybody to get up. I want everybody to work out. We don't get to the set unless we pump it up, Come on, where everybody, Tracy, you two, Olivia's mom, you get up too. I want everybody pumping.
And at 4:30.
All walk, I kid you not, through this, the town of Mexico City, through this plaza to a gym that he had set up for all of us. To stay in shape. And it was really important to him that, we were healthy, that we were eating properly, that everybody was taken care of. He was very much like a godfather, kind of a paternal figure to me during the time, because I was 14. And we all just got on like a house on fire. But I think it was very much generated from Arnold's having done the first film and sort of wanting to welcome everybody and make them feel at home. Yeah. But he's really a force to reckon with, and an incredible human being, and very funny. I know that he's had an opportunity, in Twins and certain comedic roles that he's played to play comedy, but he really is genuinely a hilarious person to be around.
You've just finished working with Mel Gibson for a movie called The Bandit. Do you know when we're going to get to see that?
I would presume... I think at the beginning of this next upcoming year, 2022, it's going to be a really fun ride, this movie. It's almost a fugitive film. And I played Mel's wife in it, which I was absolutely chuffed to get that opportunity to do, because I've always been a huge fan of Mel's. And it's just got an incredible cast. And it's set in 1984 in Canada, in Toronto, about... a convict who gets out of jail and he meets the love of his life, Alicia Culbert, and he doesn't really have any money to his name, but they have a baby coming on the way. So he decides, what am I going to do to put, food on the table, so to speak. So subsequently, he sort of walks into a you know, a shop where there's all kinds of different costumes, and he starts putting on different costumes and realizes that he can rob banks, you know, really well in costume, you know. And so he has a different costume for every bank he robs. But what's interesting is it's a true story. And this man actually in the 80s robbed, I think, up something like 250 banks and, you know, made about $4 million, which in those days was a lot of money. He did get put in jail, but then he got out of jail. And so this is a true story. Mel plays this incredible bookie who's an ex-boxer. And he and myself, we run a sort of undercover strip bar, but really there's lots of ongoings that are that people don't really know about that's going on behind the actual business of the strip bar. So
wow. What a great story.
Yeah. Got a bit of everything.
Yeah.
Hey, Olivia, we have loved chatting to you today. Thank you so much for being with us.
It's been a pleasure.